session explores solutions for meeting the needs of artists with respect to affordable rehearsal space, which is a priority for cultural planning underway by the City of New York. Please join me in welcoming our moderator, Risa Shoup, Executive Director of Spaceworks, who is joined by artists and experts in the field. And I have to say, we have a fabulous panel today, so you're really gonna enjoy today's conversation. Let's give them a warm welcome.
Conversation on this larger topic of developing affordable workspace for dance. And then with any luck, we will have over 15 minutes, but at the very least 15 minutes left for a Q&A. So I hope y'all will listen actively and kind of come at us with some thoughtful questions that gets to ground we won't cover in our panel discussion. So with the interest of time, and all of that said, let's begin with some intros. So for my panelists, and pardon me reading from notes, I'm a little ill and this is very helpful today. Panelists, can I ask you to please state your name, your preferred pronoun, why you agreed to be on this panel, and your relationship to this topic of developing affordable workspace for dance here in New York City. And I will, as a show of good faith, I can begin. My name is Risa Shoup, preferred pronouns she or they. I agreed to moderate this panel for a lot of reasons, not the least of which is our conversation will directly inform my work in my new position as the executive director of an organization called Spaceworks, which does indeed develop affordable workspace for artists across disciplines, so including dance, here in New York City. And I think that also in many ways sums up my relationship to the topic of the panel. I'm also a consultant on Create NYC, our first cultural plan for New York City, led by Hester Street Collaborative and the Department of Cultural Affairs. And that, of course, in that arena, we were also talking a lot about this topic, so we informed you there as well. Abby, can I ask you to move along?
Thank you. Hi there. I'm Abby Hamlin, and I prefer she as my pronoun. I am not alone, as I've learned very quickly here, in being a former dancer. But once a dancer, always a dancer. And I am also a real estate developer. And that's what I've done for the last 30 or so years. And one of the projects that I've developed is a wonderful rehearsal and performance space in Brooklyn. It's called the Actors Fund Theater and the Brooklyn Ballet Studio. So I am alone, I believe, in being someone who has been both a dancer and someone who has produced and developed space for dance.
Hi, my name is Jeff Rosenstock. I'm with the Kupferberg Center, Queens College, part of the City University of New York. Why I'm here today is about 5 years ago, a funder approached me when I first came to CUNY, City University of New York, to see if we could herd the cats, the 24 CUNY campuses, and in response to a report that was commissioned by the Mellon Foundation, it said artists may not know of all the resources and facilities available to them, if we could make CUNY campuses available to New York City-based dance companies and choreographers. And we've been doing that over the past 4 years. I think Alyssa's here, our director, done about 67 residencies, and we're across 13 campuses in all five boroughs right now.
Good afternoon, I'm Jerron Herman, pronouns he, him. And I am a dancer with Heidi Latsky Dance, a physically integrated dance company here in New York City. I'm a disabled dancer and also company associate with the company. tasked with doing all the background things that artists do. But also, similarly, I think I was on, I'm on this panel because I was asked, I love to just answer calls. And then I think that my kind of nascent identity with getting space or knowing about space is a common identity with a lot of artists here in the city, especially young artists. And I think that if we can think about how to provide them with resources to space in their nascent identity as artists, then that can build an infrastructure for when they become established artists.
Hi, my name is Topaz Tanjuaquio. I'm the co-founding director and of Topaz Arts, co-founded with my partner and collaborator, Todd Richmond. In 2000, out of necessity and passion, ventured out to Queens to create a space for dance and arts. And I feel like I'm here for the artist-driven solution to finding space. And just out of my own experiences as a choreographer and dancer here in New York City since 1990, just figuring out a way to make ends meet to keep living in New York City.
Hello, my name is Raja Feather Kelly. My pronouns are he, him, his. The artistic director of the Feather Theory. I'm also a performer here in New York City with a few companies. I am here because Risa asked me to be here. Recently, actually, Jerron asked me who my allies were in New York City, and the first person that came to my mind was Risa. And thinking of someone as an individual who wants to look to the sort of bigger pictures, I think allies together create alliances, and then those alliances speak to the other people who make the changes. So I'm here as part of this alliance.
Thank you all. So to begin, I'm going to ask a question of the artists and cultural workers on our panel, and then I'm going to ask a similar question, Abby and Jeffrey, to both of you as folks who are more involved in like the development of space from a different perspective. Although, of course, Abby, you were once a dancer. I love that. But anyway, so to the artists and cultural workers on our panel, could you please name and in the interest of time, two key challenges that you faced in trying to identify and use affordable space for dance in New York City? And can you also talk to us about how you have successfully managed those challenges or not?
Well, the biggest challenge for every choreographer and dancer is space. I mean, that's how we make work, is to find space. Just from my history, back in the late 90s, my partner and I have been looking for space to a collaborative space. And our dream was to create a space that would incorporate dance and arts. Of course, we looked in Manhattan, nothing. Brooklyn, nothing. Of course, it was right before the bubble of 2000. And we ventured out to Queens and discovered there's spaces to be found outside of the central downtown area. So we found a space, a warehouse space that it was completely raw and, through our own means, hurried up and formed a nonprofit, got contributions, did loans. I think everything was just this need to do it. And it was that the time was ripe that it was presented to us. We found the space, the owner liked what we were doing. And was encouraging to have an art space in a neighborhood that didn't have a, we're in Woodside, Queens. It's not typically known for arts, so it was a big risk. And this was before people even thought of rehearsing outside of Manhattan, let alone outside of downtown Manhattan. So it was a big risk, and but we just really needed to see what we could do with the space that we found. And the challenge was to, the interesting challenge was to really tailor the space for the needs of the artists. And being artists ourselves, you know, down to what thickness of the floor would be, and we made it a heated floor. And so I feel like the space is really tailored for dance and arts, and having built it ourselves from the ground up, not the building itself, but the stuff inside of it. So the floor is particular, you know, deciding what kind of marley, what kind of everything, what kind of heating was a big challenge, but now it feels like it's what makes the space unique.
I'll say a challenge that I feel that I've had is getting organizations on my side, getting them to understand what my specific needs are as an artist, and getting them to sort of be on my side with that. That means some issues maybe to help frame that are like, you can't be loud, you can't run, you can't wear shoes. And for the particular work that I do, those are things that are very important to us. And so it starts to shape the way that we make our work when those are the only spaces, that you, when you're sort of confined to working in very specific ways, and that starts to make your work look a very specific way when you have to adhere to that. And so that and consistency, finding the ability to work over a long period of time with the same amount of people in the same space, that really does a lot for artists and their teams, being able to be in the same space. The ways that I think I've dealt with that are I just get in trouble because I do what I need to do, and then I get in trouble and I apologize a lot, which is not fun, but I'd rather do my work and apologize and explain myself after. Aside from that, I've tried to develop relationships with certain organizations to have them understand what it is that I'm doing and why I'm doing that, and if they have resources available that's maybe not in their space, but other spaces. Prospect Park, rehearsing outside.
So, like, to piggyback on that, we've definitely been rehearsing outside, and actually the public space has become one of our primary advocates, or you know, and especially when we have project-based work that is in a certain context, we so there are kind of two things I'm thinking about. Challenges for people with disabilities is that, well, grandfathered spaces aren't accessible, aren't intrinsically accessible with ramps, with elevators. We have had the great privilege of being an organization that can get subsidized rental rates because of our status, and so that gets us into like the New Victory Studios, which is our beautiful, and you can kind of like peek into a Broadway show. But as well, like they are set up in a way that facilitate the work. That being said, again, to Raj's point, it's a matter of time. You know, when you're working with a person with a disability, there it's just that time to understand how you're working. You know, I think that we all give our dancers ample opportunities to explore and create movement, but when you're dealing with a distinct body, you have to, I think you have to add on a little bit extra time. Depending on your relationship with disability arts, and then also with your relationship with that person, given that there is what technique means. For us, the technique has been, Heidi has really kind of pushed forward of an embodied technique where in which you feel the movement as you can, you do it to the best of your abilities. I hate, kind of hate the phrase, but it takes time to get there. And so consistency of space and then like the accessible aspect of space are two challenges that we really face. With that being said, we have really enjoyed, we just kind of filtered into CDI, CUNY Dance Initiative, as well. And they're, you know, giving us time to do certain things as it relates to our project is really paramount. As well, I think that we delve into different types of economies. I mean, if we can get space somewhere, we will do a class, you know. Or if we're at schools, we're in gyms, we're in other places that aren't really, you know, really dance studios. So I think that alongside our kind of on the outside of the dance world, if you will, not really, but we use spaces differently as well. So I think that that is another realm that we can touch on.
Thank you. I certainly have some follow-ups for you guys, and I'm sure that you might have more things you want to say, so we'll come back to this. But I also want to acknowledge that as difficult as it is for artists to develop partnerships or develop actual spaces, especially in Paz's case, to identify space that takes a lot of time and to find space that really works for dance, it is similarly challenging to actually develop space for the arts in New York City. That's a position that I continuously find myself in, like how do we actually do that as developers? And so Jeffrey and Abby, I'd love to hear from the two of you, kind of in a similar vein, a couple of key challenges that you encountered in your work to create and or co-create the physical spaces for dance and for performance within the institutions that you were in partnership with, the Actors Fund, CUNY, et cetera, as well as just in your own work within those partnerships.
I'll start. I want to build on the notion that partnerships and co-creation is the only way that space for dance can be affordable. As a private developer, I cannot build a dance space without some involvement with a not-for-profit organization and the public, whether it's the City of New York, Department of Cultural Affairs, whether it's NISCA, whoever it might be. There's not enough, the cost to create new space is just too high to do without that kind of partnership. So in the creation of the Actors Fund Theater at the Skirmelhorn, it really was a very closely, a triangle, and I initiated that triangle. I had the vision. I knew I wanted a theater in the Skirmelhorn. And theater, I mean a black box theater with used during the day for rehearsal space. I also knew that I didn't want retail in the base. I wanted a cultural use in the base, which is how we came to the Brooklyn Ballet Studio and the home for the Brooklyn Ballet. But I could not do it alone, so I had to figure it out. It was a problem that I needed to solve. And so I went to my partners. My partners at that time were the Actors Fund and another social service group called Community, Common Ground. And Common Ground, now called Breaking Ground, we're going to be running the housing up above, some of which, by the way, is for, it's all subsidized housing, but it is set aside for actors and members of the entertainment community through the Actors Fund. The challenge was not with my immediate partners in the not-for-profit, it was then all of us working to get the city to fill the gaps in the funding that we needed it to open this space. And we actually opened the space, the theater and rehearsal space, about a year after the building was open, because those gaps in funding were ultimately for some of the finishing touches, the lighting or the projection systems, needed to be kind of several funding cycles. It wasn't one single funding cycle with the city. And I want to give great credit to my partners in this, who I have the vision. I, in fact, in donating the land to the not-for-profit, I put in a deed restriction that required a theater. When I say a theater, a black box theater, to be used in a multi-purpose cultural performance and rehearsal space. So they were required to put that in if they accepted the donation of the property from me.
And Abby, before we move on, can you just do me a favor and explain quickly, because I don't know if anyone knows what a deed restriction is, what a deed restriction is.
Yeah, that means you are legally obligated to perform not only whatever the restriction is, it is in the deed. It means that when you sell this property, this theater is there in perpetuity. It cannot be, if anything you do with this property is sold subject to the requirement that this theater space be maintained.
So I think I mentioned it, the CUNY Dance Initiative was not my idea. It was not the Kupferberg Center's. It came out of a report and a funder, New York Community Trust, Curry McCarthy, coming to us. And we realized the need was real. In fact, I want to thank Dance NYC because I think it was 4 or 5 years ago at this symposium, they gave us an opportunity to talk to dance companies. And I think I stayed literally 2 hours after the panel ended, taking information from companies. And just last year, 185 New York City-based companies or choreographers applied. I think the year before was 175. So I think the challenge was how to do it with integrity, how to make it accessible. And you know, thank God we have Alyssa Alpine, who is the director, you know, of the project. The application can be done in how long do you think it would take to fill it out?
I can't make assumptions on that, right. But it's meant
to be
something
about
that
20
you can,
minutes.
Yeah, I would say that we wanted to make it 15, 20 minutes, half hour at the max, you know, for one to do. And then also really to have the residencies not be a cookie cutter, where we had to be the same thing for every dance company in every college campus, because every dance company has their own needs for what they define as a residency at that moment in time. And each of the campuses that are participating have their own, you know, mishigas, their craziness, or, you know, or what they're really looking for. So we really try to have it done at a decentralized level, yet really monitored. And I know Julia, who also works in the program, Melissa, they're out there monitoring every single residency, you know, to ensure that expectations are met, to understand what's not working. So the challenges were how to make it accessible to the dance community. One was that simple application. B, to make it in a way that a dance company could really shape with the venue how they wanted that resident. Do you want a master class? Do you want to open rehearsal? No, I just want 80 hours of free rehearsal space. Thank you very much. It's driven by the dance company's needs. We see benefits coming to the CUNY campuses in terms of our students having master classes and also building new audiences for dance, because this is a borough-wide initiative, and how your work looks in the South Bronx may be very different how it looks at New York City Live Arts or someplace else. The other one is what all of us face is fundraising, you know, the other challenge. But we're a larger organization. I love fundraising. I have a fundraising team. And so some of the stuff that we're doing is for the common good. You know, it might be easier for us to raise $100,000 from New York Community Trust and give it back to the dance community than for 20 different dance companies to apply to New York Community Trust for $5,000 each. So that's really the two challenges.
This is great, and I think also Jeffrey and I are going to spend way more than 2 hours talking to dancers or something like that. So I'm hearing all of you, and this resonates for me in my own work as well, talk about how the space does and does not facilitate the work of making dance. And if I were to have answered my own questions, I probably would have talked a lot about what I'm hearing from everyone. And this is, you know, the way that the space can open up time so that dancers can become more comfortable with the movement and with one another and with space itself, because of course the work may stay in the rehearsal room, but at least as someone who is most often an audience member for dance, like, I hope it comes out to the public at some point, but we have to become comfortable in space in order for that to happen. You all talked one way or another around consistency, the ability for a space to be available over an indefinite period of time, both to the larger community and communities that intersect in that space, as well as to specific dance makers and choreographers who don't want to be jumping around from space to space. You talked about the way that a space can help free the dance maker from certain restrictions on sound, on the vigorousness of movement. You talked about space as a way to leverage access to other resources. So with all of this in mind, I just want to re-ask this question. How does the space facilitate the work? And Abby, I might put you on the spot first, because you talked a little bit about capital funding cycles, or I think that's what you were talking about, right? Okay, so in the way that we use space and other resources to leverage additional resources to get our work done, maybe we could start with you to flesh out the way that capital funding came in from the city and other sources to help develop the physical resources within the black box and the dance studio.
I actually did not seek the specific funds from the public, the Actors Fund, the not-for-profit. It was really important in terms of the facility that we were creating that a private developer was not getting public money. So everything really had to come through the not-for-profit. The not-for-profit was the method for making things happen. So I'm not as familiar, but I am familiar with the fact that the opening was delayed for the theater, because I know that the Actors Fund went through two different funding cycles, and I know it was New York City Department of Cultural Affairs for some specific equipment for use in the theater space. Because remember, it really is a functioning theater as well as a rehearsal space, which is one of the wonderful things about it. You can rehearse there, but you can also perform there.
Right. To its own scale.
Yeah.
Other folks, how space facilitates the work?
I think, I already talked about that we created the space for, to tailor the dancers' needs. And also speaking of this funding, allowing for the $10 an hour space subsidy. And I talked to somebody in the hallway that it was Fernando from Bax, and we were talking about how $10 an hour, a lot of choreographers and people don't know that it is a fraction of the actual cost of the space. It's just an issue that I think we need to, I don't know how to tell people is that it's a lot of grant writing to be able to offer this space. But the $10 an hour is really a way to, for us to offer affordable space. And that allows for the consistency of booking a chunk of time. And I think being located in Woodside, Queens, we don't get the hourly, like, in and out kind of companies. It's the companies that want consistent time. There's several companies that have been with us for a while that have been rehearsing like Elisa Monte Dance and Melissa Fenley, where they, you know, really created a home for their rehearsals. So the $10 an hour is really helpful. I mean, through NISCA, through other foundations that really support that creative time that they recognize, like the Andrew Mellon Foundation, they really recognize that that is a huge need for the dance field, and that we're lucky to offer that space and share the space and the costs.
Yeah, in terms of, I used to be a stage manager in the theater, when you'd have to tape down a floor and then they go, whoops, tomorrow you're gonna be in a different studio, and we're all in the showcase code, which made absolutely nothing, you know, it's annoying. But also, I think the relationships, Pascal Ryu was at Kingsborough Community College, which is in Brighton Beach area, heavy Russian community, and he started talking to Anna Becker, who was the director of the Performing Arts Center, saying, I'm interested in developing a work within the Russian community. Bingo, Anna is in the Russian community, was able to make a lot of introductions and to really have the relationships build between the dance company and the particular venue at which they're at. Then space, another example is, what was the name of the company? Was it John Jay? They got the New York Times Review. I can picture them, but I can't think of the name.
Chloe Arnold, Syncopated Ladies.
Yes, Syncopated Ladies. every New York Times critics do not go to the Outer Boroughs. I ran the theater in Queens for 22 years. I think I had 2 reviews from the New York Times, and it took everything to get them out there. But because you're at John Jay, and they had, you know, it was Midtown Manhattan, they were able to get, you know, a major review by just having their work in that particular venue. And nothing more. And then I think a lot of the dance companies have been talking to the Performing Arts Center directors, saying, what's the next step? And it was commissioning. Could we raise some money to commission work? And we're fortunate the Arts Foundation gave us some money to begin that process. But it all began to relationships while at the venue, talking, you know, taking a minute to think about what a next step might be.
And yeah, Raja and Gerard, I want to try to get to one more question before the Q&A.
I think it's difficult to, like the, I'm trying to figure out how to frame this, the, as a person who makes work, I hate that I have to think about my process in terms of trading money for time.
Yeah.
And it's very difficult to think like, okay, how much time can I afford?
Yeah.
So I have $300 that will give me, if I'm getting $10 an hour space, you know, that have these many hours, 30 hours, and I have to get my process into that time, and that it doesn't work. At the same time, we want to respect, like, I think some of us do know, maybe not all of us, you know, that a $10 an hour space is subsidized, or, you know, like, that it's a fraction of the cost. It just becomes difficult, and this is to circle back, to start to think about your work in terms of, like, how fast can I work? So that, you know, $10 an hour for the space, and then like how much is each person being paid in that hour, you know, it creates a difficult relationship then with the people you're working with, because you're like, we have to do this in 30 hours, so you come in here, no talking, stretch, like, let's go, could you come warm, like, we only have 2 hours in this space, we only have an hour of that with sound. You know, we can only be loud for 15 of those minutes because we talked to the friendly lady that lives upstairs. You know, it's like it's very tough. I should also say I've also managed companies. Right now, I manage and perform with Reggie Wilson Fist and Heel Performance Group. I've managed Kyle Abraham. I've managed Zoe Schofield and Jennifer Shuey. And so I believe that I understand both sides. Where it's like, yeah, well, you know. Time is money, and we've got to like get in and get out and, is that mean anything? This is what it feels like.
Oh my gosh. I'm just like really keyed into the, like, the definition of facilitators to make easier, you know? And then like, now that you facilitate so much tears and gnashing of teeth, but like, what comes up for me is that similarly, the time it takes to make it work, to what end, really? It's like for production, you know? And then just as kind of ephemeral as the space that we get, we have 4 nights of a show, and then it's gone until the next cycle. So it's as if the space in which we rehearsed in was just to one end, and I think that is something that's very hard to reconcile right now, especially when it's when you have to think about representation. Like, if a disabled dance company walks into a studio, you know that they are making work. You know, it's like it's just something. It's just a way to say like these people are making work because they get to be in these spaces, which is so important. I think that like to the point about 30 hours. Like the closing of Danny was so impactful on a lot of people because it made all of us truncate what we were trying to do. And I mean, we even were like, oh, we only get like 40 hours. We're gonna make a piece and then like make it Danny style, and then like we can go. Then we at least will have something to leverage to be. You know, we won't have to tell another space like, we need an extra 50 hours, we already had 50, 40 hours, whatever, to maybe ease a space and to give us more, you know? So there's this kind of, this new dynamic wherein spaces are, we're working in scarcity, always. And so I think we're always just thinking about, we have limited time, we have limited resources, what can we do within that? But I think it's detrimental because we're only thinking about a scarce presentation as well.
Yep, I think that's really, it's really important that I hope folks are really hearing that, that like, there's work that is made, oh, thank you. I was like, why is Alejandro making that weird face at me? Yes, I think it is really important to acknowledge that, again, as much as I, like, as an audience member, appreciate what I can see that is made available to the public, there's so much that, that is the tip of the large iceberg, right? And that the process, like, the work doesn't happen without the process. So we have to create the spaces that allow the processes to grow deep and to recognize many forms of practice. And yes, some of that will one day be available to a wider public, but that's not the point. The point is to do the work. So perhaps with that in mind, I have like a final question for all of us, and then we'll move into the Q&A that I really am trying to hold space for here. So for this last question, I've heard a lot of us talk about partnerships and, in a way, pressure points, right? Like, I've heard all of you one way or another say, like, I leaned on my partner in order to do this. I leaned on my partner because I wanted to do this, but I wanted to make this happen, but they really knew how to do it. And I don't think it's bad to, like, lean on partners. And it's, like, kind of, as we're all saying, what we have to do. I leaned on, like, the upstairs neighbor so that I could use the space a little bit differently than what was on paper. So with all of this in mind, how can the broader dance community, of which we are all a part, perhaps better leverage our collective power to, and you can tell I'm really reading off paper here, to successfully advocate on our own behalf with the public and private sectors for the development of affordable space for dance? And draw on your own experiences, but also like dream big, you know? Like someone out there is taking notes, I'm taking notes, like we have an opportunity with this cultural plan. Like let's really be empowered to envision new forms as well as again drawing from past experiences.
I've been really thinking about as a dream, and this has come from like friends of mine too, who are young choreographers and whatnot. It's actually like it's going back to the Jetson era of like, people had Soho lofts, like that is so, and people still do. And is there a way in which, similarly to access college campuses, are personal home studios available to people? Like, are the millionaires that were, you know, millionaires now who have access to like townhouses and spaces who were struggling back in the 50s, 60s, 70s, like what, how are they investing in today? I mean, Kathy Weiss, her loft is used to great effect. A lot of other people use their lofts to great effect.
Right.
Actually, well, it's interesting. Like, does Trisha, like, does she gift it?
I don't know.
I think it's her own. Maybe I don't know. But I just started creating a solo, and I was in a home studio loft, and I was just like, wow. Like, I kind of felt like I was in a bit of dance history. Like, it was really nice, and it made me connected to what has been. So I was like, that's kind of and that's something that I just seems outlandish, but wanted to put out there. Home studios. So held off, stand up.
Awesome. how do we harness like all of our collective power to like make the space?
Well, I just wanted to speak a little bit about the $10 an hour thing. Like before we had funding in the first few years, we just said we're $10 an hour because that's from experiences, but we know what people are, what the minimum that people can afford. And in those first few years without funding, we realized, wait a second, we're paying for your time. And until we found the funding, and when we found funding, we offered residencies and things like that. And we've been doing residencies since 2003, partnering with Queens Museum and different places, and now it's all entirely at our space. I feel like we're a little bit lucky in New York City. I feel like our funding organizations really care about the field. We're, as like, I've looked at spaces in California and how the funding organizations are there,
And even the museums out there don't get state funding as like, you know, major museums. Whereas here, we're a little bit lucky that our funding organizations really seem to care about the funding or the dance field. And I think what I was going towards, again, through history, I danced for Marley's Yerby in the early 90s. We used to like rehearse in empty office spaces and anywhere that we could find. Just to go back to before I had a space, you know, just going out and asking and finding the space, the warehouse that we found, we went and asked, you know, can we do this? I think that's where we need to go, to just ask and don't be afraid. The worst that could happen is no. And collectively, to speak our needs to the field, that, you know, I think collectively, if there is a need, people will listen.
Is there a database for space?
Yeah, there is. I mean, there's Fractured Atlas runs a really great database for space for performing arts. But I also, what I'm reminded of as I hear other people talk, and I've certainly thought about this a lot in my own work, is that what about the spaces that aren't in the database, you know, that might actually be sometimes like the most appropriate spaces, given that the work reflects any number of conditions. But yes, there is a database for sure. Yeah, that's a good question, so thank you. Yeah.
I would say, if there's anything that I like, another reason why I think I'm here is to sort of share that the picture is much larger. Like, rehearsal space, and I think you said this, Risa, is like just the tip of the iceberg. And so somehow I think working together to sort of see the larger pictures, and that's individual, that's between each artist. Like, they have their own, they may have their own idea of what their work looks like and how it can be supported. And so if we can remind and somehow facilitate, like, what is your larger picture and how can this space or how can my resource with another space help that? I think also there's a cycle that I would love to see broken, which is that you know, there are residency opportunities, there are, you know, like maybe you're in a space for the creation period, and then once your performance is over, then you're like back at square one. And so artists I don't see artists like being supported over a time that's like longer than a week, or longer than a month, or longer than a year. Like, I think if an artist was supported over like a course of 4 years, then we could really see some change in the way that art is being presented and the way that performance is looks. And then that might also inspire, like, okay, how is that person supported? How are they given, you know, what were their resources? How did that become? And then I think that starts to feed into itself in a great way. And I don't see that kind of risk. And it seems like a risk because it's, you know, the cycle now is like the artist, their $10 an hour is like paying for the space, and like that just needs to be secured so that the space exists. And so if that synapse was broken and that was handled in another way, then it wouldn't be reliant upon that.
I was first going to say in the Department of Education, but I really know working in a large bureaucracy that's even, you know, a larger bureaucracy, and I know the Department of Cultural Affairs is looking at that, and actually Julia did a study on Amaranth New York Community Trust about the wall and how to maybe climb over it. But one other thing just literally popped into my head. A couple years ago, we did an Armstrong Festival in Flushing Meadow Corona Park, and we had Miss Lauren Hill performing. And if you know Lauren Hill, she is notoriously late. And so my production manager had this brilliant idea. Instead of them rehearsing in New Jersey, we rented the Marriott Hotel's ballroom on that Saturday afternoon by LaGuardia Airport. And we were doing the festival in Flushing Meadows Corona Park and had to rehearse there. We didn't spend a lot of money on that. And it just hit me, if we go to NYC and Co., and we do something sort of like Shoshama, the theater company that uses dormant spaces for periods of times, and see if maybe that's less of a bureaucracy in the hotel industry that might have a ballroom or, you know, a breakout room available. There are mostly wooden floors, you know, on them. I don't know if they're sprung or not. But it could just be, again, for a tax donation on their part to be part of NYC's tourism industry. They don't understand arts and culture. Just an idea.
Yeah.
with us, big ideas, or if you, or do any of you want to fill in some more details around effective partnerships in your work today?
High Lansing Dance has a really ambitious project called On Display, which is a public art installation project, including up to 35 performers with and without disabilities. And that has taken us to so many different areas outside of the national, like the theater system in a way. We've done it through public spaces. And to your point about bureaucracy, it's funny, it's great to have partnerships with actual people within the DOT and the Mayor's Office for People with Disabilities, which we do. The UN Secretariat of People with Disabilities has been our ally in hosting installations at the United Nations. So I think that individuals have, anything, like fundraising, coordinating a show at a major space, you have to, it starts with the individual. And so I actually kind of now advocate for partnerships first, and then what can you do in that space? What can you do in that area? I think this might facilitate the length of time you have a partnership. If it isn't predicated on a job, then you have this kind of leeway to say, we're gonna be friends forever. And that might yield something different. We've had incredible times in the public spaces we've been performing in, only because it's about that visibility aspect. We said, what's the aspect of this project? It's to make people who are often seen as marginalized or often seen as not in the public realm to be made public. So we said that we have to be in the most iconic spaces, at least in New York City, if not with our partners around the world. So the thing that, the artistic entity has to understand is what end is your space being used?
Yeah, I want to really overemphasize that. So again, I'm in this new job. I run this thing called Spaceworks. We are a developer of affordable space for dance and many other disciplines, and we work in concert with the public and private sectors. And I have often done work like this, and now I get to really do it in this new job, right? I've been involved in the production of space in different ways throughout my career, but now it's my one job, and I'm incredibly grateful for that opportunity. But I'm not gonna do it well if I don't have these kinds of conversations, and the conversations I hope we will all have together, because I am not a dancer, I am not an artist. I'm fine with that, it's totally happy. But I'm helping to create resources for people who are artists. So in the way that Abby so generously and genuinely spoke about needing to find a partner in the Actors Fund and in the Brooklyn Ballet Company to make appropriate spaces for that work, I need to talk to individual artists and individual developers and individuals who occupy other places, like Jeffrey, so that I can help figure out how to have conversations in partnership and have conversations with artists and ultimately create spaces that are genuinely effective within people's cultural practices. Because if I just went and did it on my own, it would just be whatever I wanted it to be, and it's really not about me. It's about all of us together. And my comfort and my place in that can't be too important, because I'm not using the space.
Risa, I just want to add one thing.
Yeah.
You ask about how can the large dance community and arts community advocate for itself.
Yeah.
And I think one thing I don't want to miss is, let's turn it around and talk about how important you are to New York City. And let's make sure that we never let the city forget that, or the state, and forget it with the federal government. The important thing is, when I envisioned the idea of the theater and the dance studio at the Skirmerhorn, I envisioned it, yes, because I wanted the cultural space for the dancers and the people, actor, the musicians, all the different people who use that space. But I also wanted it there because that street was dead as could be. It was empty. And all of a sudden, I have a ballet studio. Well, I can't tell you how many people stand on Skirmorn Street and look in and watch the dance classes, watch the little kids, watch the adults. They're fascinated by this. People who've never seen dance are now seeing dance. But that's to their benefit, as well as to the dancers' benefit. So I just want to make sure that, you know, part of the power of who we are as a group is what we provide to this city. And it's so multifaceted. I've just touched upon a few little things here. But we are a city of where arts and culture are the heart and soul of what we want to be. It's a humanist approach. It's the arts and culture bring us together instead of pull us apart. And I think we need to continue to advocate for our very visible presence in the city.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Abby. So audience, we have, by my read of the clock, 24 minutes and a couple of seconds. Yes, I see you, Sydney, to get some questions from you guys. And I wanna be really clear about something. You have one developer, one quasi-developer, someone who runs a massive partnership amongst public higher ed institutions, dance companies, artists, and other individuals. Two brilliant dancers and choreographers, and another brilliant dancer choreographer who also created a space in Woodside, Queens. So it's like, there's a lot of perspective here. You got 24 minutes to ask us your best questions, and we're gonna start with the best person to do that, Sydney Mosley. Go.
Hey, y'all. Thank you so much for all the comments you offered. So I have three burning points slash questions, which we may not be able to answer. One is Paz, is that how you say your name? Paz, I'm sorry. You started speaking about how you found a space in Queens, and that triggered me a little bit because a lot of times I'm thinking about like how we're entering spaces and how we're entering, to use Urban Bush Women's language, entering building and exiting communities. And so I have questions about, and this is not directed towards you specifically, but how dance makers or people who have the ability to build new dance space are entering communities and building there, and what their relationships are to those communities. Because gentrification is real, Columbusing is real. Like, there's a lot of imperialist leanings when we talk about just going and building a space. So that's one thing. The second thing is just to echo what Raj has been talking about in terms of who gets to have space and just to like be free and have space and make, and how crucial that is to young dance makers and young in practice, not young in age. And so how do we get to a place of merit in our work to get a space grant if we never even had the space in the first place to develop the work? So I just want to put that into the space. And then the very last thing is, there are so many existing dance spaces that do not have the resources to actually get the grant to underwrite the space, right? So I live in Harlem. For every bit of my body, I wish I could only be and make my work in Harlem. And there's a million tiny little dance studios, but they all charge 25, 30 plus more an hour because they literally don't have the infrastructure in order to write those types of grants. So how do we come together and use our people power in order to support the existing spaces in those communities so everyone can make art at home?
Thank you so much, guys. Okay, I'll speak to this a little bit. You have to promise me with a nod of the head that you're going to fill in, because we all have a responsibility to respond to this. Great. So, Sydney and all of our friends here in the room, this question of like how not to Columbus comes up for me a lot.
my, long before Spaceworks existed, and at the very beginning of my career here in New York almost 13 years ago, I worked for Shoshana. And we entered a lot of communities in order to develop space. And I probably did a lot of like awful racist things, I'm sure of it, because I, you know, did not, I had not yet been awakened to an anti-racist, anti-imperialist way of working. But I worked with people who had, both artists and fellow administrators. I'm very grateful to them, because one of the things that they taught me, and I believe all of you kind of share this with me from our conversations, it goes back to this question of like, talk to who's there. You don't enter community, I mean, you could, you can, it's like really easy for white people to do this especially. You can walk into a community and be like, here's your thing that I got you, use it, and use it well. And then you can leave, and leave havoc in your wake. What you can also do that I think works much better is to enter community and listen. You don't even have to ask anything, because people are already talking about what they need. Just listen to them. And then build your thing with them based on what they have said they need. And as we're talking about partnerships, you bring in your resources in order to help community meet its own demonstrated needs. So that's one thing I can touch on. Another thing, I think, with regard to all of the questions you asked me around, which in some way have to do with like how people access resources, I believe that artists need to keep making their work, and that keeps getting harder and harder and harder. But they need to do that, and the, those of us who provide resources to artists, I think, have to listen more deeply to them and figure out where the gaps are and help fill those in. Because the artists know where the gaps are. You don't need to be told. You need a bridge, or you need like whatever word we want to use. And that is, as a provider of resources, I've often found that to be the most fulfilling work that I can do. Okay, everybody else, now.
When we found the space in 2000, you looked at the neighborhood, right? And the neighborhood was predominantly Irish. Historically, then it became Filipino, then it became Indian, then it became everybody on one block. And our first community board meeting that we attended, it was kind of scary. Because it's a working class neighborhood. And Queens does, it's changing. It no longer is Archie Bunker, but back then it still was. So the community board meeting was kind of scary. They're actually discussing what's happening today is the St. Pat's parade that's happening in Woodside, Queens. It's the first inclusive parade, Irish parade that ever happened in New York City. So there was a debate about that, including LGBT community in the parade. So we're like happy and also terrified that there was this debate about it. But now it's a growing thing. And the neighborhood has changed. And being in the neighborhood, it is a working class neighborhood. And we've discovered our neighbors starting to come to our events. And you know, then you build an audience that was not a dance audience before, where you know, you invite them into your events. And that's how it becomes a community. And when we first started, you know, they didn't know what dance, or, you know, the immediate neighbor thought we were gonna be a club. We were like, no, we're not gonna be a club. It's dance, and so it's actually working with the neighborhood you're entering in is very important. The last question you had, actually the Mellons Foundation did a survey, and they found that no additional spaces were needed for dance, and that there needed to be more support for those spaces that do exist. So I think they just need to research again the spaces that need, like communities like Harlem that do need more support. So again, speaking out and, I don't know, finding out, seeking out funding for those spaces that do exist.
I want to say, I think that we lack, I think that New York City lacks like the culture around culture, like a culture that celebrates culture. I've had a couple of conversations with different artists where they don't feel comfortable like criticizing or having dialogue about each other's works, which I think could be beautiful and celebratory. We don't have that. And I think that also, again, so I was in another like group across the hall, and there was this great example of like what the tip of the iceberg is versus like what's underneath. And it was a fantastic model. It's like broken my mind about how to explain things. But I'm thinking about what are all the other things that go to support like healthy, beautiful culture that is like creating performance and art. And I believe we need to build culture around it. Like, for example, I have been working recently uptown at the Signature Theater, choreographing for plays. And their culture around like how they support playwrights for over 5 years, and how, you know, they have like opening parties, they have closing parties, like people get excited about that kinds of stuff. And I don't see that happening where I'm making work downtown, down here. And I think those things help. Like, people get excited to go out to see the work, to like have their picture taken, to like see that like, oh, this person has been supported for 5 years. Like, what are they doing? You know, how does my work relate to that? How can I be in conversation with this person? They're gonna have a talk back, they're gonna have an open dialogue, they're gonna like walk backstage, there's all of these things surrounding the artists that are there so that people can also know how to talk about their work. And then there's the people that come to see it that say like, oh, I want that, or I'm gonna create that for myself, or I want to, you know, have my work in dialogue with that, but maybe repeat. And I feel like that's also needed, and I think that's related to this, to like making affordable space. Like, what is that space, and what does that space create?
To the language, I'm like really about affordable. Like, the merit question that you presented was like hit me too, especially as I'm a young artist too. I had an experience where the criteria for this grant was didn't apply to me yet, although my willingness to do so was there. And I actually think that if we're thinking about intersectional identities, that disability does kind of get out of the realm of the conversation, mainly because space is like, if you were here before, Simulinton was speaking, she said it's expensive. And to add a ramp, to have an elevator, even to have people who have the language, you know, like writing a pamphlet takes money too, for you to understand like how to facilitate someone else's artistic process with a disability, I think. And because it's such a diverse catalog, you cannot pigeonhole. So then therefore, like, oh, well, then if it's this kind of daunting task that no one really wants to like touch. And I get it, I really do. But I think that in that sense, the merit question is so hard to answer, because you're saying like, well, okay, there aren't a lot of representative disabled artists, so therefore, like, how do we know that they're ready to create work to this magnitude or go to BAM, or, you know, because it's like we have this hierarchical structure that is so ingrained. So it's like, okay, so I don't see anyone at Dixon Place yet, so that means that they can't go to Nyla, that means that they can't go to ADF, you know, like, so there's this kind of just like this thing that I see as a hindrance, but also as if the good disabled person can like filter into that, then they'll be fine. But it won't make it affordable, you know, it won't be a pipeline that anyone who wants to do that can go through. And I think that's the aspect of affordable that I'm kind of keying into. Like, oh yeah, like one person can do it, but can 20? Can people over 20 years do it? So merit, I don't know how we're going to characterize merit right now.
Can I say one last thing? I wanted to wrap up my thoughts for a moment to say to anyone out there who's like running an institution, I feel like the question I'm trying to ask is like, what is the culture? Like, what is the culture of your institution? Not just the culture that like the people are trying to make from the work in your institution. And I think that will help.
We have time for, I see we will get 1 second to your question. Yep. I just want to highlight something that's coming up in response to the questions that Cindy asked and the other things that we're saying, which is that, you know, one thing I don't think we've talked about concretely is like, how do you develop space for dance? Like really, how do you build that thing or redevelop the existing thing in order to do that? I think part of why we haven't talked about that is because there are systems that exist for that to be able to happen. It's not a mystery. It may be harder for some people to access the information about how to do that, but it is in fact a science, right? There is a method or various methods with which to do that. The parts that we're talking about are all the things around it that again make that space effective, make it useful to all the kinds of people who might use it, and therefore open up that might to be inclusive of many, many kinds of people, not just those who are often seen or seen the most in the space. I do think this is the real meat of the thing. Like, I'm sure that Abby or myself or any of these guys really could talk to you literally about how you build space, and that might be interesting to you, but that information exists. This stuff that's going on around it, this is the most important conversation. I'm very grateful to have the time and space to have this now. Victor, go.
Okay, is this on?
Yes.
Okay, two small things. One of them is that some years ago, because Dancing Crane Cultural Center wasn't a cultural center, we decided we needed a space, we wanted to do lots of classes. So we rented a space, we fixed it up nicely, and we have it. And now, Monday through Friday, until 6 o'clock, it's virtually empty. It's a modest-sized, lovely, small space, not too small. So, a couple of years ago, I looked into the NISCA $10 program, and as I recall, and I'm a fairly good grant writer, it required commitment to a certain number of hours of use. And I couldn't commit that. I get virtually zero requests at any price to use the space during that time, and we filled up the evenings and the weekends with our stuff and so on. So I don't know how to bridge that. I'd like to apply for it, but I can't commit. It's like a circle. If we had it and we advertised, maybe people would come. It's Bensonhurst area, okay, that's first thing. Second thing, our real problem is venue for performance. And except for the Actors Fund Art Space, which I'm very grateful for, it's overbooked. And there any other space that we've found is much more expensive and very difficult, and they're overbooked. So we have a problem. We have like six different kinds of performances we want to do, and we don't have a space to do them. That's our problem.
I do think people would come if you opened up your space during daytime hours, having, I'm watching Barbara put her vest on, but we both have accessed made hourly spaces accessible in the daytimes, and I think a lot of you guys have used them, and a lot of you guys are doing that too. Possibly you're doing that on Woodside. People will come and use it.
Well,
it is. I'm not taking away the burden that it takes to advertise it or push it to people. That's a lot, but people will use it. I just wanted to say that. Anybody else in response to the things that Victor was saying?
That's what they, in that study, found that there's unused time that is available that exists that people don't know about. So I think people would come between 10 and 6.
Yeah.
It's a popular time with a lot of companies that rehearse during the day. So it's about finding those people who need time.
I just want to say quickly, for something like that, I think of your former employer, Fab, did this incredible thing, and you know, they helped the other spaces in the area access artists to those unused times through a collective model. And so I think instead of having to kind of invent the wheel on your own and how are you going to rehearse, you know, rent this rehearsal space, maybe it's partnering with an organization that does have an artist in residency program or has rehearsal space that they handle, like in the Fab model.
I don't know this.
So yeah, maybe I or Risa could talk to you a little bit about that, because then it's a way to access a larger network and also not have to take so much administrative work on your own.
And then I think that same study, which is the Mellon study, which is what CUNY Dance Initiative was created on that premise, is the outer boroughs have real human beings out there. You know, they can go to the theater. They do go to the theater. They also want theater, or I use the word theater because I come from the theater, or dance that is accessible within their own neighborhoods. So there's a sense of shared community. It's not, they're not the bridge and tunnel crowd crossing into Manhattan, but they have that sense of community. And so I think there's a lot of space. We had to nudge the dance companies. If you look at the applications, originally everybody wanted to be at Baruch or John Jay, what was the third one?
Or
City College versus the outer boroughs. We did a little incentives for stipends for travel, but now Alyssa told me this year it's kind of evened out a lot more, where people are discovering there is life in the outer boroughs, and there are a lot of pretty incredible venues out there too. You just won't get the New York Times unless you bring them.
We got 5 minutes. And I know I said my spiel about like how you construct a space is, there's ways to learn that, but does anybody have a question about that? Because this is a good moment to ask.
Yes. I have a question actually for Abby, because as I think we're talking about, there do need to be new spaces. Sorry. And so I think my question for you is more, is this the only space like this you've done? Or do you expect another one along the model of the Hoyt space? What were some of the challenges? Maybe you would never do it again.
I would love to do it again. This space was created through a variety of very unique circumstances, not physical, but financial. And you know, this is in the base of a building that has 50% of its units for formerly homeless individuals and 50% for low-income individuals. So it's supportive housing. I loved to work with other supportive housing developers and try to put some cultural space into the base. So I have tried. I now sit on the board of the Actors Fund Housing Development Corporation, so I can't quite partner with them at the moment, but I would love to try to do something with them again. I am working on another arts-related facility, not a performing arts-related facility, but one in which there will be space created for fabrication, really the fabrication of art. So, yes, I would do this. I love this. This is, you know, the great joy of my life is being able to work on projects that have the artistic component, the creative component, and support New York's art community. My day job, if you will, is for-profit housing, and it pays for my ability to participate in these other aspects of what are important to me.
That sounds like a beautiful way to end this conversation, to reveal that yes, like there are folks on all sides, public, private, and any blend of the two, who want to do this, and we are all a part of that, right? Like we all have power and resources that we can leverage to better meet our own needs. So thank you to my panelists, thank you to all of you for being part of this conversation today. The work continues.